Let's talk about some of the basic ideas of statics. So, statics in general. Is that helpful? Statics in general. First of all, let's talk about the difference between statics and dynamics. So statics is basically stuff that doesn't move, like static friction, right? You use coefficient of static friction with something's not moving. It's not really that it's not moving, it's that it's not accelerating. So, you know how the idea is, like, if I'm at a constant speed, it's like I could be still and the whole world could be moving at a constant speed or whatever. As long as something is not accelerating, then it's considered to be static. But in general, when we talk about statics, we mean like a table. It's not moving. Statics would be something like that. Dynamics, which is a whole other exciting class, has bodies in acceleration. So bodies accelerating. So like a rocket. Like that. Okay. Really moving bodies, but bodies undergoing some kind of acceleration or rotating, right? Because whenever you're rotating, you have acceleration and stuff like that. Statics is very easy, actually. The entire course can be pretty much summed up by sum of forces is zero, sum of moments is zero. And that's basically statics, so now you're done. So we'll write this out. Sum of forces, and then sum of moments. There you go. Not spinning. And we spend a lot of time studying statics, particularly, and you say, well, why? Because, I mean, if nothing's going on, why is it such a complicated issue? Well, part of it is that we design things in general, hoping that they don't move. You know, like when you design a table, you really don't want it flying through the air. And if you design a computer mouse, you know, it's not going to be, well, maybe that's a bad example, a keyboard. A keyboard is not going to be accelerating. So we design things all the time with the assumption that they're not going to accelerate. Throughout statics, you'll have a lot of assumptions. The main one is always, and it always will be, assumptions. Assume the cow is spherical. We do a lot of overarching, perhaps, assumptions. The biggest being a rigid body. Meaning that all the particles in an item stay the same distance apart. Same distance apart. And this is important because it means that you're not going to have any bending, so no deformation. So whenever you see the word rigid body, you should think that there's no deformation. So there's no bending, there's no twisting, there's no none of that kind of stuff. Nothing's actually breaking. Okay? We also tend to assume, sea level. We assume everything's happening at sea level, so it's not like, oh, well, we're on top of a mountain, so something weighs such and such slightly different, or whatever. We assume sea level and a latitude of 45 degrees. And this can actually not be a good assumption, depending on what you're doing. Obviously, if you're looking at rocket trajectories, it matters where you fire from. So, but in general, for statics, because it's not going anywhere, it doesn't really matter where we're starting it or where we're building it. So we call this a standard location. Okay? So we'll stick with those as our basic initial assumptions, and then we'll go from there. Okay. Some things that are important to know, some review from probably a physics class, is you've got Newton's law. Newton's law. Like that. Remember that the force between any two particles is given by the gravitational constant times the mass of the two particles times the distance between them. And that G is going to be equal to 6.673 times 10 to the negative 11. Your units on that are meters cubed over kilograms squared, which is just basically a bunch of junk that makes the whole thing come out to newtons. Because you want force to be in newtons. So if gravitational constant has all those silly units there, then it comes out to be newtons. In general, since we're assuming that we're on Earth at standard sea level and that kind of such, and so, we usually rewrite this as the idea that weight equals mg. And in metric, g is 9.8 meters per second squared. It also is 32.2 feet per second squared. Okay? Good? Now, in general, this is on Earth. So the idea is that if I set the radius as the radius of the Earth, and this is the mass of the Earth, and I use this, these all equal 9.8 meters per second. So that should have been something that you've seen before in physics. If you're looking at statics, hopefully you've seen physics. Otherwise, it's just going to be a disaster. So that's all kinds of fun. Now, while we're talking about weight, one of the things that happens all the time in statics that you'll see students do is don't convert, not convert, maybe the right word is, don't multiply, if you have something pounds by 32.2, or 9.8 for that matter. So what'll happen sometimes is you'll have a force and, you know, you'll have a little, whatever, a little particle, and we'll know that the particle has a mass of 10. And we'll say, okay, well, what's the force and that this particle has? What's the weight of the particle? And we'll say, okay, well, let me say 10, is that better? 10 kilograms. And so its force is 10 times 9.8, which is 98 newtons. Okay, so the force or the weight of a 10 kilogram particle, it's not a really small particle, but whatever, is 98 newtons. Now the problem comes in is that later on you're going to have a problem that says here we have something that is 10 pounds. Okay, and because you just kind of in the mood, you're going to end up multiplying this times something, or if you're really not paying attention, you're going to multiply it by that, which is bad because you need to remember that in forces, 10 pounds is a force. This is not a mass, it is a force. So that's why they say, well, you weigh differently on Earth than you do on Mars, because you have a different force that your body exerts. So if I weigh 10 pounds, well, that would be terrible. If I weigh 10 pounds on Earth, you know, I would weigh 33.2 pounds or something like that on Mars. If I have a mass of 10 kilograms, that's the same wherever I am in the universe, okay? So let's talk right quick about your unit systems and make sure you've got these straight, because you don't want to be doing anything weird to pounds, because it's already a force. So if we go with systems of units. All right. You've got basically the metric system, or SI. System International, and then FPS, which is a customary. Okay, I kind of have these backwards, so let's say the more specific term for what we're going to do is SI, which is metric, and then we're going to do FPS, which is customary. Okay, we've got length, we've got time. We've got mass, we've got force, I think that's on the page. Okay, your metric system for length, hopefully you got this one, right, maybe, meters, time is seconds, mass in metric is kilograms, and force is measured in newtons. Now newtons are also kilogram meters per second squared. This is called the derived unit, which basically means that these are the ones that we stick with, and this is the one that we calculate. Now for FPS, we've got a basic unit of length of a foot, again, time is seconds. Mass, if you remember, this is the one we never see anymore, is slug. It is actually the one that is a calculated unit of pound second squareds over feet. Yeah. And then the force is in pounds. Okay. So these are the set ones. And then the slug would be the calculated one. So whenever you see that something has a mass of kilograms, you need to multiply by something to get it to a force. If something is given in pounds, you already know the force, so don't do anything to it. And that's kind of, I think, the whole point of going into this. Okay. And while we're going into this, remember that I'm multiplying kilograms times 9.8 to get into newtons. And I don't know if I said that, but again, I'm assuming you've had physics, so that this is kind of easy peasy. Make sure you've got your unit prefixes are really important to have. So we've got 10 to the 12th, and you should know a lot of these because of computers. And here we go. Alrighty, and working down from these, you should have tera, giga, like terabyte, gigabyte, megabyte, kilobyte. So if you've been doing computers since the 80s, these are, it's like, I'm doing my little 1.44, whatever. Yeah, exciting. Centi, milli. This one's fun, micro. And nano. And pico. If you care, these three are kind of in alphabetical order. So every once in a while in my brain, I'll confuse nano and pico, and then I just remember they're in alphabetical order, and that kind of helps me. And you've got the numbers. So capital T, capital G, capital M, little k, little c, little m, mu, n, and p. Okay? And here's a fun story. Because my husband's also an engineer, and we like to travel, and it's fun. And we were in Greece. And in the States, this is, I believe, a micron, the symbol for a micron, which is 1/1000th of an inch. So 1 micron is 0.001 inches, okay? But in Greece, this is just, so this is US, but in Greece, they're using actual Greek letters, so mu just means M. Right, because that's M in the alphabet. And so they'd say the bridge ahead has a clearance of, 15 meters. But being engineers, we'd look at that and say, ha-ha, the bridge has a 15 micron clearance. And we'd giggle, and it was awesome because that's what we do for funsies. So if anything here is just desperately confusing, then statics is just not going to happen. So go ahead and review this stuff. And the reason that these, prefixes and stuff are important, so if they say, my particle is 10 grams, you've got to convert that to 0.01 kilograms. So then you can multiply it times 9.8 meters per second to get 9.8, really? Am I having a... Go two this way. I think I did that right. 9.098 newtons. So you've got to make sure that you're in the right unit system or the right prefix. Otherwise things get kind of bumpy. But this is a good start in making sure that you're comfortable with all this to move forward with statics in general.